white?
Black.
Huh? You still black? Yeah, how still you change when you come to South Africa?
I don't know. I like it black. Yeah, Allah.
You know?
Yeah.
I want to have the pleasure of sharing with you.
Yeah.
My experience of going to Dubai.
Mashallah.
They call me what they call the young presidents. Uh-huh. There is a society called the young presidents.
Mm-hmm.
And some of these leading lights.
Yeah.
Of the Jews. Begin and them, they have taken that. You know, they joined the young president. Before becoming the presidents,
yeah.
There is a type of training that, you know, certain leading life they get.
Mm-hmm.
So they invited me to Dubai.
Good.
To speak to the young presidents.
Uh-huh.
And we landed there. We went to the Jabal Ali or something. You know,
yeah, Jabal Ali, free zone area. Fantastic, beautiful. Many factories.
The seaside resort.
Seaside resort, yeah.
I think it was Abu Jabal Ali or something, the name of the place.
Sea is very clear.
Ooh, and the gardens and the, you know, these hotel and all
yeah,
that.
Yeah, yeah.
It was, you know, the
beautiful hotel in Dubai is Jabal Ali Hotel.
Right.
Yeah, right. Beautiful hotel, I like it.
So we were accommodated there.
Yeah, very good.
And the conference starts. But before that, everybody is given an identity. Who you are? He says, Osam.
Yeah.
Osam.
What is your job?
Right. What is your occupation? What you are interested in, or your field of activity?
Yeah.
Oh, I say, I am comparative religion.
Mm-hmm.
You may be an astronomer, or a mathematician, or whatever it is you put down.
Yeah.
So now everybody has got that identity.
Yeah.
So, meet around and say, hello, Osam, how are you? So in the meantime, I'm reading, you see,
yeah.
Archaeology. So I'm interested in archaeology. You see, man, he says, where have you been specializing? It's in Egypt. So now we get used to, now I want to know something about archaeology in Egypt. So we sit down and start chatting. So in other words, now, if the label shows your intent, they say, wear it.
Uh-huh.
The label shows you what you stand for. I'm karate. You know, man. He said, no, I'm not interested in karate.
Okay,
no, interested in karate. He said, karate? What belt, you know?
Uh-huh.
I said, no, I'm fourth belt. This man was sitting here. He's a fourth belt karate.
Yeah, I see him already. Enter Islam, new man.
Right. So now, see, the label, you start talking straight away. Uh-huh. You know, by the label. Otherwise, I don't know, so what work you do, where you come from, and all that kind of thing, bored, you know, tired, and nobody has got the time, everybody's in a hurry.
Yeah.
So, this is what they put on. So now, that gave me an idea.
Mm-hmm.
That we ought to have a label. The label tells you what you stand for.
Uh-huh.
Right? And I found the advantage of a label. This trip of mine to America.
Yeah.
We land in New York, Kennedy Airport. And we go in that file, everybody's there, and then one of the immigration officers is free.
Yeah.
So, from a file of the queue, you go to that one.
Mm-hmm.
Another one, free, it goes to another one, so like that. So we go to this, all three of us together, me, my son, and my grandson, Rais. We were together, you see. So we all go, three together, usually one, but now because we are together, I present the passports to the immigration officer. Three. So the guy, he opens the passport, looks for the visa. He finds it and he stamps it. Next one, he looks for the visa, he finds it, he stamps it. Next one, he looks for the visa, he finds it and he stamps it. Automatically.
So
he's doing his job.
Yeah.
Once he's done that, now he looks up. To look at me, you see.
Uh-huh.
And he sees this.
He's for Muslim.
And he sees my son and my grandson. We're all in a row.
Yeah.
We've all got our topi on.
Yeah.
Kufia. You call it kufia?
Yes, yeah.
So he's asking, what is this for, sir?
Mm-hmm.
I said, no, this is our identity to identify us that we are Muslims.
Good.
He said, what is that, sir? He is not trying to be funny. He is not trying to pick up a fight.
Yeah.
You know, he sincerely wants to know,
yeah,
what is a Muslim? An officer of the American government, educated man, holding an important position, he wants to know what is a Muslim. So I said, you don't know? We are 1 billion Muslims in the world.
See, now we don't know what is Muslim.
And we follow the religion of Islam.
Yeah.
He said, what is that? Hassan, that man is not trying to be funny. He sincerely wants to know.
Yeah.
So I started explaining to him. While I'm explaining to him what Islam is,
yeah,
the people waiting in the queue,
yeah,
but they don't know what we are talking. They think it must be something to do with immigration, you see.
Yeah.
Fortunately, people are not standing immediately behind us.
Yeah.
They say, what the hell, man, look, I'm waiting here, and you know, you damn it all, you're you know, discussing about religion. So I'm explaining to him what Islam is. So while I'm explaining to him, something tickles him.
Mm-hmm.
Say, yeah, yeah, you are the people who don't eat pigs. Somehow you know,
yeah, yeah,
that the Muslims and Islam, they don't eat pigs.
Yeah.
I said, right. I said, why?
Good.
He's not trying to be funny.
Mm-hmm. You go, yeah.
He sincerely wants to know why.
Yeah.
So I started explaining to him. I says, man, this thing here, open up.
Mm-hmm.
A venue of communication. This thing here. You see? There are tens of thousands of Pakistanis who passed the guy. Mm-hmm. He did his job. And Egyptians passed him, he did his job.
Yeah.
And the Saudis passed him, he did his job.
Yeah.
He's not interested.
Mm.
This made him interested. On our way back to New York from Chicago,
yeah,
in the plane, the lady is asking, what is this for, sir?
Mm.
She knows about the Jewish camp.
Yeah, yeah.
But this thing is something bigger than that, you know.
Yeah, bigger than
that. She wants to know, what is this for, sir? Same, same story. She sincerely wants to know.
Yeah.
To me, man, it's an opportunity for delivering the message.
Yeah?
The man. What's that, sir? He says, Allah. What is that? I said, no, this is the name of God Almighty.
Yeah.
Starts a conversation.
Mm-hmm.
We had another one, the Qur'an speaks the word of God for universal guidance.
Mm-hmm.
What is this Qur'an, sir?
Yeah.
So man,
many questions.
An opportunity for you to talk,
to
deliver the message of Islam.
Very good.
Most innocent way.
Yeah.
Now, they organized a lecture for me in New York, for ladies only, 100% ladies.
Yeah.
The man who took me, his wife was in charge, she was a chair lady, he had to go.
Mm-hmm.
The man who took me to the meeting,
yeah,
to address the ladies, he had to go away.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because all 100% ladies. Yeah, very good.
Except me, I'm the only one man.
Yeah.
I look at the ladies. There are some Pakistani ladies, there are some Afro-American ladies, there are some Arab ladies, they're all in hijab. 100%, 100%, every woman. In New York!
In New York, very good. This means that behavior still...
100% in hijab. Not this, the Iranian type,
yeah,
or the Arab type.
Yeah.
But, you know...
Yeah,
to me, 100%. To me, that's
100%. 100% hijab, yes. Okay.
So I congratulated them. We have to congratulate. In the city of shit.
Yeah.
New York.
We're still wearing
one
hijab.
Third of New York are gays, sodomites,
Qawmulut. Yes.
Among such a people, my daughters, my sisters,
mm-hmm,
are all in hijab.
Yeah.
In the city of New York.
Mm-hmm.
So I congratulate them. But at the same time, I have a complaint.
Complaint?
Yes, yes, I have,
yeah,
a complaint.
Yeah.
I said, look, you my children, I'm so happy,
yeah,
that you are 100% in each other. But I said, you know, I have a problem.
Mm-hmm.
The problem, your husband,
yeah,
and your sons. I said, they in the masjids, they have no identity.
Yeah.
In my lectures, they come, there's no identity.
Mm-hmm.
There's nothing on.
Yeah.
I want to know why. You identified yourself that you are Muslimas. All. 100%.
Yeah.
I want to know how is that 95% of your husbands and your sons, they don't identify themselves in New York.
Yeah.
I want to know
not
why.
Easily this year.
I want to know why. Maybe they are afraid that somebody might bash them on the head for being Muslims. So you Muslim?
Kill him.
Maybe.
Yeah,
but in that case, I say the bloody cowards, the hypocrites, they want you to identify yourself. Mm-hmm. They don't mind you getting bashed. They don't mind you getting killed, but they want to be saved. I said, the bloody hypocrites, your husbands and your sons.
Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah.
That's hypocrisy. Mm-hmm. So I'm asking, how many are you in New York, Muslims? So they tell me there are 800,000. Twice the Muslim population of the whole of South Africa is in New York.
Mashallah.
They have more than 110 masjids in New York.
Only in New York? Not
in New York,
America.
Only New York.
No.
There are 110 places of worship in the city of New York. 800,000 Muslims. Twice the Muslim population of the whole of South Africa is in New York alone.
Mashallah.
But they have no identity. Mm-hmm. They have no identity.
Yeah.
You are lost in that ocean of 8 million. There are 8 million people in New York. In 8 million, 800,000 get lost.
Yeah.
Nobody knows you.
That
you are there.
It's a high percentage.
I know. But because it's a center, it's a city, the United Nations is there, this, everybody goes to the from the East Coast, you go there and you find something to do, you don't want to move on, you find Michigan, in fact, you settle down there, that's easy, like Durban. People came, ship came here, first thing you don't know if there's anything they can do here. You don't want to go to Newcastle, you don't want to go to Johannesburg, you don't want to go to Cape Town, if you can get a living here, you don't look for the
others.
We find most of the people are here. Mm-hmm. There are more than 30 masjids in and around Durban.
Very good.
Why? No, because the people came. The people came and they were settled on. People come. They got absorbed.
Mm-hmm.
So 800,000 Muslims. I said, you know, if you only identified yourself, you will appear like 8 million. You will look like 8 million. Because, man, you see, you look at the people, the guy with the white cap.
Yeah.
And that's the only thing you are seeing.
Yeah.
It's an amazing thing. There are all, there's an ocean there, but the only thing that you witness is the guy with the cap. The cap.
This means
it terrifies the enemy. It awes him. There's so many Muslims in New York. Does our government know that these guys are conquering the country without a bloody gun? Look at them, man. They are, look like they overtaken New York.
Mm-hmm.
Because that's what you see.
Yeah.
You know, what you see, registered. The other are like sheep and goats. No identity, like sheep and goats.
Yeah.
The one with identity is like a Sher Babar. You know, he's a lion. In India, we Muslims are 150 million. A minority of 150 million.
Yeah.
Unimaginable. You are a minority of 150 million. That, I think, is more than... There are so many countries in the world that don't have a million. Swaziland, less than a million, is a nation.
Yeah, United very strong.
Lesotho is less than a million. They are the United Nations.
Yeah.
Here, Muslims, 150 million Muslims.
Nothing.
And they're not worth two penny. They're not worth two alalas
in
the country. But a handful of Sikhs compared to us, handful. A handful of Sikhs. In India, they are a power compared to us.
Yeah.
They are a handful.
Yeah.
Indira Gandhi was bending backwards to appease them, and Rajiv Gandhi gave them everything except independence.
Mm-hmm.
But we 150 million, we count for nothing. Why? Why? You tell me why.
No administration.
No
working.
No.
From what?
No identity. Damn shit. You know, look, man. Half a dozen soldiers, if you're standing around here, when you go back, you're going to say, hey, South Africa, Durban is full of soldiers. You know, there's on a war footing.
Yeah.
How many did you see? Half a dozen. You know?
Half a dozen.
You didn't half a dozen, six.
You
saw only six, but the picture, man, the city was full of soldiers.
Yeah.
The city was full of soldiers.
Yeah. And there's three main points.
Right. You saw only six.
Six.
But your impression is,
maybe 600.
On a war footing. The country is on a war footing.
Yeah.
You know, maybe it's this impending war.
Yeah.
150 million, no identity. Six have an identity.
Mm-hmm.
Right. they have a special type of turban, they have a special type of beard. You know that?
Yeah.
And the beard grows, they don't allow it to grow, and it goes back again into the turban.
Mm-hmm.
They don't trim.
Yeah.
Goes back again.
Mm-hmm.
So you can recognize that this guy is a Sikh. You know, his, you know, the way he, the whole thing is worked,
yeah,
and his uniform, mm-hmm, they all wear uniforms.
Mm-hmm.
I went to Hong Kong in 1977.
Yeah.
I saw a Sikh standing outside the bank, guarding with a gun.
Mm-hmm.
I saw another Sikh driving a taxi. I saw another Sikh riding a bicycle. I saw another Sikh walking with his wife. In my mind, it created an impression that Hong Kong is full of Sikhs.
Mm-hmm.
Sikh are not Sikh people.
Yeah.
Sikh in their language means a lion.
Mm-hmm.
And he looks like a lion.
Yeah.
The 150 million, they look like sheep and goats.
Yeah, no use.
No identity.
No identity at all. Yeah. No effect.
Nah.
For the government, no identity.
Now, nah. I said that because of identity, that there is a power.
Yeah.
150 million, no identity. Everybody is like this. And this is suits the Hindus. Because when you are like this, he says, you are psychologically, you are terrified.
Mm-hmm.
You don't want to be identified as a Muslim. That's what he wants. He doesn't want you to identify yourself as a Muslim.
Mm-hmm.
You want a job?
Must.
What's your name? So you give a name, it's Muhammad Ali. So,
okay, no job.
No, he won't tell you that.
Yeah.
No. I says, yeah. Yeah, details. I said, look, leave me your telephone number. You know, I will come back to you. Okay?
Yeah.
Yeah. No job.
No job.
It was Hossam. Hossam, I don't know whether it sounds like. Maybe, sorry. You might have a chance. You might have a chance of further interview. You might have a chance. You know? But now, as a Muslim, they want to dissuade you. I'm reading the literature,
mm-hmm,
the Hindu militants.
Yeah.
They said we must dissuade them from wearing a headgear,
mm-hmm,
and we must dissuade them from using a Muslim name.
Mm-hmm.
Psychologically, you're already defeated. You're castrated. You know castration?
Mm-hmm.
Your balls are cut off, you know? You beat a khassi.
Yeah, you know, khassi? As in Iran, they do with the Muslim people.
No, no, you did it yourself, my son. Oh. You did it yourself. You castrate. Once you lose your identity, psychologically you are terrified. You don't want to be identified.
Mm-hmm.
That's what he wants. If 150 million, if they put on a headgear, it'll awe the enemy. So many Muslims in India, we didn't know. Looks like they're more than us. In New York, there's so many Muslims, it terrifies the enemy.
Mm-hmm.
And it boosts your morale. Say, hey, I don't have it. Assalamu alaikum. I said, Akhi, where you come from? If you have an identity.
Yeah.
Like this, I don't know whether you are a Palestinian,
mm-hmm,
Christian or Muslim, I don't know. Or whether you are a Jew,
yeah,
I don't know. Whether you are a Hindu, I don't know. Whether you are from India or Pakistan, I don't know.
Yeah.
So I'm afraid to start with you.
Mm-hmm.
But if you had an identity, Assalamu alaikum, Assalamu alaikum. Say, where you come from? You say, Egypt. You say, oh, mashallah. You know, I've been to Cairo. Huh?
Yeah.
I'm telling you, got
time.
Huh? He said, look, man, I'm looking for an accommodation. I say, yes, sure, sure. Come. Oh, I'm looking for the masjid. So because I see a Muslim, Assalamu alaikum, Assalamu alaikum. He said, the masjid. Maybe you're a Chinese, you don't know what is a masjid.
Uh-huh.
So he said, Salat, Allahu Akbar. So he said, come. He'll take you home for a cup of tea. Maybe you take you for me because you are a Muslim.
Mm-hmm.
Muslim to Muslim. Immediate bond. I said, these are the blessings of identity.
Mm-hmm.
You owe the enemy and you boost your morale. And our Nabi Kareem Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he gave us the psychology of numbers.
Mm-hmm.
Identity. He said that when the Eidains come, go to the Eidgah for Salat. And take your women and children with you. You heard that before?
No.
He said, take your women and children with you. For Eidain.
Yeah.
Out of town.
Mm-hmm.
Out of the village. Out of Medina. Or wherever you are. Go out of town. Then he said, take your women and children with you. And he said something more than that. He said, even menstruating women.
Mm-hmm.
Even mensurating. You know what that means? When their monthly comes along.
Yeah.
When the monthly comes along, they're not supposed to make salat.
Yeah.
Then why does our Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam inflict this extra burden upon them to go for Eidgah when they are not going to make Eid? The salat they're going to, not going to make. Why?
Mm-hmm.
Think. Hussain, you know, you are a very intelligent person.
Yeah.
I want you to think that now, why drag your mother there, menstruating mother,
mm-hmm.
and your menstruating wife, and your menstruating sister? Why drag them when they're not going to make salat? Come, tell me now.
Yeah.
I want you to ask the Sheikh of Al-Azhar, that this Hindi fellow is telling me that this is what our Nabi said. Is it true or false?
Yeah.
Why should I lie to you? Why should I invent this? I have heard from the alims that he said, our Nabi said, even menstruating women.
Yeah.
Why menstruating women? When they're not going to make salah.
Yeah.
You know why?
About the blood coming out.
They're not supposed to make salah.
Yeah.
Then why drag them? Why drag your mother?
Mm-hmm.
Why drag your wife? Why drag your sister? Why? Why drag them? Why you drag them there?
Yeah.
Then they're not going to make salah.
Mm-hmm.
That's cruel. You are cruel to them, man. You know why? The psychology of numbers.
Mm-hmm.
You see the psychology of numbers. When that menstruating woman goes, her 3-year-old is with her. The 5-year-old is there. The 11-year-old is there. Now, it creates an impression there are so many Muslims in Medina. There are so many Muslims in Verda. There are so many Muslims in Tonga. There are so many Muslims in Stanga. So it terrifies the enemy psychologically, and it boosts your morale. So alhamdulillah, we didn't know we were so many Muslims.
See,
the psychology of dragging, menstruating women, so your little ones will go, your 3-year-old, one in the 5-year-old, 11-year-old, everybody is there. That's the psychology he taught us. But you too damn clever.
Usama was saying that Islam is not in the head.
No, I agree with that.
Yeah.
You see, I'm asking, some of our young generation, I said, look, identity is very essential. So they said, yes, but you see, Islam is not in the hat, it's not in the beard.
Yeah.
I said, that is true. I want to know, where is your Islam? You say it's in the heart.
Yeah.
I said, with Allah, no problem. Between you and Allah, no problem. If you deserve Jannah, Allah will give you. If you deserve Jahannam, hell, Allah will put you there.
Yeah.
He won't make a mistake with you because you had a nice beard.
No.
You won't go to Jannah. Because you had a nice turban, you won't go to Jannah.
No. Depending about our works.
Your iman, your faith, your actions.
Shame is not important.
Right. So the beard is not important in his sight.
It's
and the trophy is not important in his sight.
Yeah.
Your iman is what Allah is interested in.
Mm-hmm.
But I said, look, with Allah you won't make a mistake.
Mm-hmm.
But me, your brother, I want to recognize you, so I can wish you in the street, Salaam Alaikum. Blessings. Are there blessings with salam?
Mm-hmm.
Every salam you wish, people?
Yeah, I wish.
And opening the door?
Yeah.
When a guy recognizes, Salaam Alaikum. He says, where you come from? In the masjid you meet people, say,
where you
come from? He says, I come from Egypt. He says, no, I'm with Mr. Deedat. He says, come. He says, now come and have tea with me. Come and have lunch with me.
Yeah,
otherwise, you're just passing by another sheep or a goat. You know, another sheep or a goat.
Yeah.
Nobody knows.
You might be a Christian. You look like a Christian. So why must say Islam?
Like in Egypt.
Yeah.
In Egypt. I don't know who's a Muslim and who's not.
Yeah.
I
see.
You know that? Because the Egyptian Christian looks like you. They say there are 15 million.
Yeah.
Right? You can't make out the difference. So now, then your names also don't make a difference.
Maybe not difference. Now the Christian people...
Similar names. Tariq Aziz.
Tariq Aziz is a Muslim.
He was a Muslim. Suleiman Farangi was a Muslim.
Yeah.
I didn't know. Because to us, every Suleiman is a Muslim. Every Yusuf is a Muslim.
Yeah.
Right. So now, identity. Identity. Once you identify yourself,
yeah,
immediately it opens up the doorways for you.
Mm-hmm.
If you're sitting in the underground railway, one across the other, you know, in Western societies, we don't ask one another where you come from.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know that?
No.
But Islamic culture, as soon as you know, Assalamualaikum, Assalam, so where you come from?
You want to make relations, you know?
No, that's not our
heart
culture.
Heart. Our culture.
Where you come from? Yes, I'm from Pakistan. So, say, you're from Pakistan. Where about in Pakistan? I said, Karachi. Ah, I said, I was there for 3 years in Karachi. You know, I used to live there. Huh?
Yeah. Start to make a new relation. Very nice, yeah.
Identity.
It's very important in this spirit.
So now I said, now, if that is that important, in America, man, 800,000 Muslims in New York. No identity.
No
power.
Yeah.
You identify yourself, man, you terrify the enemy. Without taking out a gun, without throwing a grenade,
you're
shaking up the people. So many Muslims in New York, so many Muslims in Chicago, so many Muslims in Washington, D.C.
Yeah.
The Jew is prepared to identify himself.
Yeah, but Muslims don't know, is it possible?
So now I'm asking, what is it? It's an inferiority complex.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe you are ashamed. Let's say your name was, your name, surname was Hitler.
Yeah.
You are the great grandchild of Hitler. Now every time you say my name is Albert Hitler, or your other brother is, you know, Moses Hitler.
Mm-hmm.
Every time you say Hitler, somebody's ears goes up. You say, Hitler? He said, yeah. He says, that Adolf Hitler. He said, no, he was my great grandfather. I said, that bastard. You know, on account of him, 40 million people died in the Second World War.
Yeah.
That puts you in a defensive position, apologetic.
Mm.
You know, you have to apologize for your grandfather. Every time you open your mouth, you got to apologize.
Mm.
You say, you are the son of Abu Lahab.
Yeah.
Huh? Every time you have to apologize, Abu Lahab, say Abu Lahab. You know, Abu Jahl, you are his grandson. Abu Jahl's grandson. Look, you'll change your surname.
Yeah.
Am I right?
Yes, you are right, yes.
You want to change your surname.
Mm.
Because every time you open your mouth, somebody starts asking, Abu Jahl. You say, well, you know, Allah doesn't was the Allah says, you know, no bit of a burden is. My grandfather was Abu Jahl, but you know, I'm a good Muslim, I hope inshallah. You know, I believe in the Prophet, I love the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now all this apology, why do you have to apologize? Huh? If you have some reason to apologize for being a Muslim, being identified, then I can understand that every Muslim is a terrorist, every Muslim is a murderer, every Muslim is a rapist. Then I say, take it off. Because every time you say you're a Muslim, that means you're a terrorist. Every time you say you're a Muslim, that you're a rapist, you must rape his mother, his wife or his daughter. Then I say, in that case, every time you say I'm a Muslim, you know, you have to apologize for it, then take it off.
Yeah.
But, man, this asset, this is an asset. I'm telling people, identity is an asset, it's power.
Yeah, power, yeah.
Tanzania, 80% of the people are Muslims. Did you know that?
No.
Hmm? No identity.
No identity, yeah, nobody knows.
Not only that, outwardly they all look alike. The Christian Tanzanian and the Muslim Tanzanian, they look alike.
Mm-hmm.
Same race. Then no headgear. Then you have not even your name. We say we are the Muslims. We are the Muslim. We are the Muslim. And identity. You say we are Muslims. They say they're Tanzanians. They're Tanzanians. What are you? I'm a Tanzanian.
Yeah.
So now, in the University of Darussalam, 90% are non-Muslims.
Oh.
A nation of 80% Muslims, in the University of Dar es Salaam, there are only 10%. 10% Muslims.
But they are the Muslim.
There's a conspiracy. There's a conspiracy of keeping the Muslims out. Otherwise, I think that the Muslim, once you are a Muslim, you become a bloody goat.
Mm-hmm.
You become a bloody fool. You become a loony.
Mm-hmm.
A lunatic. Is that what it is? Islam does that to you. Then I said, no, get out of Islam, man. If Islam does to me, that because I become a Muslim, I lose my senses. Mm-hmm. Then I must leave Islam. If that is the case, as soon as I become a Muslim, I become people's doormat. Leave Islam. Allah is telling us that as a Muslim, this is giving you a deen, li yuzahirahu ala deena kulli. A deen has to master overcome and supersede them all, kulli. Bulldoze them all, kulli. That's your destiny, man. You're supposed to be the bulldozers of mankind. Flatten out all batil. وَقُلْ جَعَ الْحَقُّ وَزَعَقَ الْبَاطِلِ إِنَّ الْبَاطِلَ كَانَ. This is your destiny. But now you choose the role of being a doormat or being a punching bag for people to practice on you. You know, in boxing they do that, yeah? Man, once you identify yourself, it terrifies the enemy and boosts your morale. So, the Muslims feel, you know, and opening up doorways, communication, doorways for you. You know, man, help comes to you immediately. You know, you are there in India and some Hindu picks up a fight with you. I got this.
Yeah.
Some Hindu picks up a fight with me.
In India?
For example, I'm in India.
Yeah.
And some Hindu, we have some disagreement and we come to blows. And there are half a dozen Muslims. They recognize me, that this is our uncle, and you know, if that Hindu fellow touches him, we'll jump into it and we'll hit that Hindu chap.
Yeah.
But me, I'm looking at the people standing around me, they all look like Hindus.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm terrified.
Yeah,
I can't recognize them. My brothers are waiting to help me, I don't know them.
Yeah.
They know me because I got a headgear.
But, you know, yeah.
They recognize me, but I don't recognize them. I think they are all enemies.
Yeah.
As a result of that, I throw in the towel and I give up my rights, my haq.
Yeah.
Identity.
It's very important, I think.
So I'm telling my people here.
Mm-hmm.
They have developed a habit. In the masjid, alhamdulillah, you watch.
I see, I watch you.
Almost 90% yeah. They have it on.
They ask me to wear it. I said, okay, no problem.
No, 90% they put it on.
Some mudir now is going to the mosque.
No. 90% they put it on. But when they come out,
it's not when
they come out, you watch, bulk of them, they put it away. So I'm asking why?
Mm-hmm.
Why do you do that? You're afraid. You're afraid of what? Somebody will kill you. If that is the case, then put it away.
If you're afraid, yeah.
If that is the reason, I say shave it off.
Yeah.
Shave this beard off.
Yeah, yeah.
If your life is in danger for being Muslim, recognize. If they can recognize you're a Muslim, they'll kill you. Then I said, look, some of you arrived here, shave off your beard and the topi, put it away. Suppose you're wearing one, I said, put it away.
Yeah.
But otherwise, I said, no, if you have this on, you are boosting your morale, an outside blessing. Assalamu alaikum, assalamu alaikum, assalamu alaikum, assalamu alaikum. You walk down the street, you watch the guys, they all look like me, without the beard. You'll find all the shopkeepers, they look like me. Now you don't know who is a Muslim or a Hindu. 80% of my people are Hindus, 80%. Did you know that?
Yeah.
Of the Indians are Hindus, 80%. Captain Noe
sir,
huh?
Noe sir,
right.
Yeah.
So, as I said now, in Verulam, 20% of the Muslim of the people are Muslims, in Verulam.
Yeah.
In Stanga, another town, a little beyond us, 30% of the people are Muslims. Now, I said, if they only identified themselves, you terrify the enemy and you boost your morale. Your women folk are safer. You see, there's a Muslim fellow there.
Mm-hmm.
See, somebody wants to start interfering with your wife. Listen, there's a Muslim fellow there. There's a Muslim fellow there. And all that power, identity gives you. In South Africa, our fathers who came here, they were illiterate people, poor people, beggars.
Yeah.
I told you my story when I came in 1927 at the age of 9.
Yeah.
I had a calico shirt, and calico trousers. Calico they don't wear anymore, they don't use them anymore. Calico only used for kafan, you know, when the people die.
Yeah,
we use for kafan. But those days I was wearing a calico shirt and a calico trousers.
Yeah.
No shoes.
Oh.
Then the winter came. So my father bought me a coat.
Yeah.
Now the coat, we didn't have handkerchief. Handkerchief was, I used to see people, you know, they were very highly tidy people, they keep it here.
Yeah.
You know, well folded and all. For sure. I don't know whether they used it, but it was more for show.
Yeah.
You know that I'm somebody great.
Yeah.
I didn't own a handkerchief. My hanky was my sleeves. After eating, I wash the mouth and then. And if the nose is dripping, this thing starts shining. And nobody in my life ever told me, Ahmad, what is that? Why is that like that? Because they accepted that was so.
Yeah.
This is the only way to clean our nose. This is the only way to clean our mouth. Wipe our mouth. Such abject poverty we were in. At that time, my fathers, they won the freedom of putting on a headgear in a court of law. See, they believed in identity. So they go to the court, they put the topi on. The magistrate judge says, take it off. I said, no sir, we are Muslims. We'll take off the shoes if you like. But not this. This is our way of showing respect. So we got the right in a court of law to retain a headgear. In South Africa.
Yeah.
The Hindu must take it off. The Christian must take it off. The Jew must take it off. But you go and put it on. In South Africa.
Yeah.
This is what our forefathers, they won for us. And we voluntarily be throwing it away. Voluntarily, on your own. I want to know why. Give me one good reason why you should throw it away. When our forefathers, they fought for this.
Yeah.
And there's endless blessings in being identified. Salam, salam, salam. Salam, salam, salam. Huh?
No need to remember.
Are you my brother? Are you my brother? Where you come from, my brother?
Yeah.
Are you married?
Yeah.
I can talk to you like that.
Yeah.
The Christian, the Western, I can't. Are you married? What work you doing? I said, who appointed you? Mm. Are you an inspector?
Yeah.
Or a special branch? MI5 or what? What do you belong to?
Yeah.
Huh? So now the thing is that I'm telling people, learn to identify yourself.
Yes, please.
So I had a young man, university graduate, working for me.
Yeah.
I gave him this lecture.
Good.
And he says, beautiful lecture. Lecture is beautiful. But he still doesn't wear. So look, what I'm telling you, if it's haq, and if it's beneficial for Islam and the Muslims, I want to know why you don't want to put it on. If your life is not in danger, if it's good for Islam and the Muslims, I want to know why you don't want to identify yourself.
Yeah.
Give me one good reason. So the guy doesn't. He doesn't. You know?
Yeah.
I'm lecturing to him, he agrees. This is a beautiful lecture. You know what I'm telling you about identity and all that? This is fantastic.
This is
fantastic arguments, reasoning, logic. Our Nabi said, you know, take your women and your menstruating women to show your power.
Mm-hmm.
You go for Hajj. When you go for Hajj, we are supposed to bare our shoulder.
Shoulder, yeah.
Huh? Why? You want to show Allah a point? You want to show Allah, say, you see me, ya Allah, you know, look, I got muscles. Is that what you want to show Allah?
No.
Then why?
Because the behavior of Muslims must be the same, rich and
but
poor.
But why you go out of your way to say, look, if the shoulder was covered,
load it.
Yeah.
Say, uncover it.
Mm-hmm.
You know why? You know why? The psychology behind it.
Yeah.
What's the psychology?
Psychology is to be edification or...
I don't know who you're showing. Who you're showing. You say, no, usually you show this.
Yeah.
To the enemy.
To see that Muslim is power and...
Somebody, you know, look.
Right hand side.
That is the psychology. But now, you're showing to Allah that?
No. It's for our enemies.
This is our Nabi. When they went for that Hajj, the mushriks were still watching. So they said, bare your shoulders.
Yeah. right-hand side.
Right,
all of us.
Right.
Yeah.
So the guys who are watching, they get terrified. See, yeah. These look like all they are athletes. They're all like super wrestlers.
Yeah.
You know, they're all like strong people. Mm-hmm. That is the psychology.
Yeah.
Our Nabi taught us. And you want to throw it away. I want to know why. Mm-hmm. Show your power, man. By identifying you, showing your power.
Yeah.
That we are Muslims. We are Muslims. It's a silent salesman. You're a silent salesman for Islam. Mm-hmm. The guy wants to know what is all this. Why? Open your door. Talking to him, man. Preach to him.
Yeah.
So, my dear brother, Hassan.
Yeah.
There's a saying that if you convince a man against his will, he's of the same opinion still. Mm-hmm. You know, you can convince a man.
Yeah.
But the guy remains the same because in his heart of heart, he doesn't want to. What may be, there's a sickness. There's some psychological factor. Mm-hmm. You know, some kind of inferiority complex that you have developed unknowingly.
Yeah.
I say every Muslim, I'm telling the Saudis, when you go outside, in Saudi Arabia they seem to be identified, the Saudis. You know, when you go out, I want to know why the hell you want to take it off. Mm-hmm. What are you afraid of?
Saudis.
You must go out of here, to me.
Yeah.
I'm telling the Saudis, the Arabs, you must go out of your way. You stand in every street corner. Anybody passes, say, good morning, says, good morning.
Yeah.
I'm from Saudi Arabia. You know what you're doing? You become the greatest ambassador for your country.
Yeah.
Wish the people, man. Wish them. Mm-hmm. Anybody passing by, you are, if you are identified, just like this, and you say, good morning, says, good morning. The guy is thinking that maybe you want some cigarette, you want some sweets from him. You know, what you want?
Yeah.
But now, if you got your uniform on, assalamu alaikum. No.
This means it's official.
You don't know the guy.
Yeah.
He says, good morning, good afternoon. You shake hands with the guy.
Yeah.
And he said, I'm from Saudi Arabia, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
So that's ambassador office.
Go into the video department, they want to see you about this machine.
Yeah.
About the, your tape. Just go and see them.
Yeah, I see
them. They have a problem. They have a problem with your tape. Go and see
the
them.
All same.
Go and see them.
Okay.
Okay, when you finish.
Okay.
Go and see them. You know, it looks good. It doesn't be karach.
Right.
Remember, I'm going to
call you. Oh, yes.
You know, it's already 1 o'clock.
Yes.
See Kasim as well about your distinction.
So, Sheikh Ahmed, thank you very much for this lecture. I'm very happy. Thank you very much.
And this one too, the Salah Kamals, you must give it to him.
Yeah, inshallah.
He was in this office.
Yeah. He's in Egypt. He phoned my brother-in-law, Salah Kamil, in Egypt. He dialed the phone when I am in his home.
Yeah.
Salah Kamil was you. I said, okay, but...
Was Captain Lewis on the phone?
Yeah. Okay, yeah. Thank you.
There's your camera here, Osama.
Water? Yes, yes.
Huh?
Right. So you are from Al Qahira?
From Al Qahira, yes. This is my name.
Mashallah.
And I may add my phone numbers if you would like.
Yes, I want your phone number. Muhammad Al Qadi. Please.
I come here just to salute you, dear brother, and to say Shakar Allahu Lak, not only us, but God. Just I have seen many of your tapes in Malawi. I had been ambassador to Malawi.
Right.
And my residence there, they said you went and visited the place.
Right.
Do you remember the residence of the Egyptian ambassador?
I remember something faintly. Yes, yes, in Malawi. Yes.
He told me.
Yes.
Mr. Ahmed Deedat came here.
Lilongwe, in Lilongwe.
Lilongwe.
Right.
Yes. So it is my pleasure and honor to come and see you as a brother in Islam. As a great da'iyah, alhamdulillah. If you give me your pen, I'll write down my phone number.
And if you have fax number as well, if you can.
The same phone number of office is a fax number.
All right.
I have seen at least 30 of your kids.
Allahu Akbar.
And my children, they are grown up.
So you are more like my fan. They call fan, you know. In this is your fan. Fan means a fanatic. You know that your yes.
Let us for Islam, but you are my dear brother.
Jazakallah.
Jazakallah.
I'm so happy to meet you.
My
brother. But I want to give you some shocking news.
What?
The Plain Truth magazine, Christian magazine.
Hmm.
Plain Truth. At one stage, they were giving out 8 million a month free. 8 million. They stopped giving the figures now. But in that magazine, March, they say an Albanian testament. The European Christian Mission completed the first translation of the entire Bible into the Albanian language.
Mm.
After the problem.
Yeah.
You know, communism is finished. Now the Christian got an opportunity. An Albanian New Testament has been available since the Marxist government collapsed in 1991. Immediately, they had the thing ready. At that time, an estimated 500,000 copies of the New Testament were distributed. Half
yes.
a million.
Yes.
Gospel giveaway. The World Bible Society distributed about 618 million. Not 6 million. Not 618 million Bibles and Bible texts worldwide in 1992. This total included 16.8 million complete Bibles, 13.8 million New Testaments, like Gospel of Matthew, Mark, Luke or John, 13.8 million. 48.3 million Gospels, mean 1111. The New Testament was 48. The Gospels mean the books, Matthew, Mark, Luke or John. And 539 million selected Bible texts. The figures which do not include Bibles sold by publishers, people who print and sell them, they're not talking about that. They're only talking about this World Bible Society. They mm-hmm. did this. Sold by publishers. Indicate only those biblical texts distributed by the World Bible Society. The number of complete Bibles distributed was 7.9%, lower than the figure for the preceding year. However, there was a slight increase in 1.7% of the gospel distributed.
They are working hard everywhere.
Compared to them, what are we doing? Wallah, nothing. They are training missionaries.
No, alhamdulillah, al-khayru fiyya wa fi ummati ila yawm al-qiyamah.
May Allah accept.
This is Brother Ahmed Deedat. There are some brothers in the Gulf area, in Saudi Arabia. They are also those people. They are doing a lot in Indonesia and the Far East.
Christians.
Too much work, yes.
They are boasting that they converted more Pakistanis into Christianity since independence than in the previous 100 years of British rule. They are boasting that they have converted 5 million Bangladeshis into Christianity, almost all after independence, than in the previous 100 years of British rule.
Because they are needy people. You know something, I had been to Malawi as ambassador of Egypt, Egyptian ambassador. At the border, there is a high road bordering the two countries,
right?
Malawi and Mozambique,
right?
60 kilometers are the border line,
right?
There, people were fleeing from the conflict
right.
between the Renamos and the government,
right.
and so on.
Right.
The church, all churches of the world are represented in Malawi. The church are there to help. But they are helping those who testify to be Christians. As for Muslims, they say, being Christian first, we are going to give you food and help. So some of the businessmen, the well-off businessmen of Malawi, they were collecting money to help also, and to somehow to compete and to prevent conversion of the needy people, the people in very bad need, they're almost dying, hungry, barefooted, almost nothing. So they were receiving them, waiting for them at the border areas. That I saw myself.
No, they have the every little advantage they can take.
Yes.
They're going to take.
They are always alerted.
But they are alert. Long beforehand, you know.
Yeah.
But now, you see, we Muslims, we have failed. There's a war going on in Sudan between the Muslims and the enemies of the southern Sudanese. And in that battle, it is more like Islam and Christianity. The battle is between Islam and Christianity.
Mm-hmm.
I went to the Sudan on a lecture tour. It took me 15 years to get a visa. I learned there, and before going, I learned the language of the Dinka. John Garang is a Dinka. That's his tribe, like Sulu, Khoza. These are different tribes here. That Dinka, he is a Dinka, John
yes,
Garang.
Yes, yes.
Mm. So I get three Bibles in the Dinka language from overseas. I'm going, I said, now I want to be prepared. I want to talk to the Dinka in his language. That's my hobby.
You are very clever, alhamdulillah.
To me, it's just a natural thing. Yeah. You know, if I can speak your language, I win your heart, then it's easier for me to communicate with
my
you.
My language is yours.
I know, alhamdulillah. So now, I learned that language of the Dinka from the Bible. Then I land in Khartoum, Hilton Hotel, and I go to the reception. I say, Assalamu alaikum, wa alaikum salam. I say, you know, I've been trying to learn your language. He's thinking Arabic, you see. I said, now listen. If I make a mistake, you must forgive me. So saying, I said, Apiata basin, we are kilikis, Apiati nunu quick, tijal an, nasha jil, ke dujil ashibu inunu quick, una. Aladi kabatuch inunu quick. The man said, no, that's not our language. Ah, I said, I thought, you know, it's a Sudanese language. He said, yeah, yeah, that's the language of the Dinka. There, that guy there, a porter. He said, he's a Dinka. So I go to the porter. I said, you know, I was trying to learn your language. You know, if I'm murdering your language, forgive me. But I want you to hear. So I repeated to him. He says, beautiful. Where did you learn this? I said, I learned it in my country. He can't believe it, that I am a non-Sahur Sudanese, and all the way from South Africa, and I learned his language. So I'm asking him. I says, you know, you people, before the white man came, were you able to carve out of wood the shape of a man or an animal? I said, yes. Could you mold out of clay the shape of a man or a woman? I said, yes. I said, now this God of yours, what's his name, by the way, first I asked him, what's his name? He says, Nihalik. I said, did you? You could carve out of wood and out of clay shape of things. Yeah. Did you make an image of your God? He says, no. I said, why didn't you? If you could make a shape, why didn't you make the shape? He says, sir, Nihalik means light. How can you make a statue of light? Actually, he's telling me, Allah nurus samawat wal ard. Allah is the light of the heavens and the earth. And yet we call him a kafir. This is a kafir. These are all kafirs. Amazing. He is nearer to you than the Jew. He is nearer to you than the Christian. The Christian says that Jesus Christ is God. Born of a woman. Circumcised on the eighth day. He is his God. This man says, my God is light. Nur. Nur, he's saying he's Nur. And you say he's a kafir. You treat him as a kafir. Till the white man came and Christianized him. The white man came and Christianized him from 6,000 miles away. And he's given him the Bible in 40 different southern Sudanese dialects. 40 different dialects. For the three alone, for the Dinkas. Three different dialects for the Dinkas alone. 40 different. I'm asking the Sudanese, how many have you given in translation of the Quran? In what language? I said, no. We want him to learn Arabic. I says, man, when you want to sell something to somebody, you learn his language. You want to do business? No, first you learn his language to talk to him, communicate with him, before you can win him over. But now you say, no, he must learn my language. If that's what your forefathers did when they came to do business with us, you know, bartering the dates for our muslin cloth, our turmeric, our tamarind. He said, now you learn Arabic, then I'll do business with you. You would have starved. You don't stop. Stop. I say, you know. Just, Jamil, Jamil, whatever this is, you know, beautiful, sweet. So now says, what? So says, you give me something, I give you something. I give you this. So he comes along with something, he says, this. Says, this. So she says, all right. For this I give you so many dates. That's how you did business. You tried to communicate with the man in his language. You just can't say, you learn my language and I do business with you.
No, this is not the way. This is the wrong way, of course.
The Christian is doing it. Yes, learn from him, man. Learn from
day
him.
Day and night, they are doing it.
They're learning. They want to come to South Africa, they learn the language of the Zulu in 3 months.
I tell you something, dear brother. The German ambassador to Malawi, she was a lady.
Right.
And she was visiting churches,
right.
Spending, she was an old lady,
right.
Spending the night amongst them. Everywhere she goes, she was concerned of Christianity. She was too much alarmed to see one putting the Arabic or the Islamic dress. You know, he was a Saudi. Putting, you know, the very well-known Islamic or Arab dress. She was too much alarmed and she delayed her departure to some places in the north. Every week she was going to churches in the bush, not in the big towns. So they are doing all of them at a time.
They have the feeling for the deen. We haven't got it.
I received some people from South Africa several times. You know, the relations were severed.
Right.
61.
Right.
We
right,
had
right.
A relation before, then by 61 it was severed.
Right.
Cut off.
Right.
So, but some from different places. I remember those of Darul Uloom in Newcastle.
Right, right.
They came to me and they have asked for Arabic books and teachers.
Right.
I was in charge of Africa for some time,
right.
So I recommended
right.
To send both
right.
Books
right.
And teachers.
Right.
And they replied, as for books, okay, we can send our program for Al-Azhar or ordinary governmental schools. But as for teachers, we have no relations. So we are not sending. I replied again, you have two. We are dealing with Muslims. Not with the
South Africa,
the apartheid.
Right.
We have to help them.
Right.
In the beginning also, their way to Egypt or to Hajj via Egypt.
Right.
It was blocked.
Right.
But we sat down together, myself, we were, at that time I was a second secretary.
Right.
And studied it and said, now we are banishing Muslims and non-whites. So what is that?
What is that crime?
You have to give permission
right.
At least for, we don't say Muslims.
Right.
Otherwise you will be
discriminated. Right.
So you can put it the other way.
The blacks.
No, you see, we put it.
Right.
As for Hajjis,
right.
Going to Hajj
right.
Via Egypt,
right.
It was permitted that
right.
Time.
Right.
And again, as for students
right.
Studying in Egypt,
right.
It was also permitted,
right.
But in a separate paper,
right.
Out of the passport.
Right.
We put down the number of
right.
The passport,
right.
Yes,
right.
But not on a page of the passport.
Right.
It was settled that way.
Right.
So it was a kind of compromise.
Right.
Otherwise, you
right.
Were to banish
right.
Muslims and the blacks.
Seven, you can't recognize them
so
from four.
As far as we could,
right.
We did it the correct way,
right.
in a way. So they are working hard,
yes.
All of them,
right.
Intelligence,
yes.
Embassies,
right.
And first of all churches,
right.
All kinds of churches.
Right.
And Muslims say here, just beside the door beside you, Malawi,
right.
The gardener, my gardener, he doesn't know, he was saying when Ramadan comes, and Ramadan, you know, we have passed Ramadan 4 or 5 months.
Months.
I said Ramadan is
gone.
Next year.
Yes, next year. Right.
And he was a Muslim.
Right.
And his wife was just in the embassy by night, just taking a bus in the open. And the security man was terrified what kind of Muslims are there? I said, keep quiet, wait. Then I tried to convince him, this is against Islam, you are a Muslim, then try to be a Muslim. Then when in Ramadan came several times, I was telling him, this is Ramadan, take care. Are you going to fast? He said, no, I can't do it. Otherwise, I am not working in the garden. So it needs efforts, and you are doing quite well in here and in the world, alhamdulillah. And I say again, shakar Allah. Lak, not me, but God, shakar Allahu lak, what you are doing.
Now my biggest cry is that we Muslims have been the masters of Egypt for 1,400 years. Islam is there.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
1,400 years. Mm. When the Muslims came, those of your ancestors who accepted Islam, they multiplied. And those that didn't accept Islam, they also multiplied. They are claiming that there are 15 million Christians in Egypt.
No.
What? They say there are 15. They say 5, I say worse. If you say 5, I say it's worse than 15. Because that 5 million have got 40 million Muslims under control. You see, in other words, they got you, you know, you can't move. You can't implement the Sharia because of the 5 million. Mm. They're going to cry. They say, you know, you're going to chop off hands, this, that, that. The America said, hey, you barbarians, what are you doing? And Germany will crowd, and France, everybody will say, you barbarians, what are you trying to do to our Christian distance? So, that 5 million have got you under control. Whatever. I said, now, you multiplied and they multiplied. And in 1400 years, you could not reduce the percentage of the Christians by one. I want to know why. And Allah is telling us in the Quran, He's given you a deen, He said, لِيُزَهِرَهُ عَلَى الدِّينِ كُلِّ. A deen that is to master, overcome and supersede them all, kulli. Bulldoze them all, kulli. Whether it be Hinduism, Buddhism, Christianism, Communism, Judaism, every ism, Islam is destined to master them all, bulldoze them all. وَلَوْ كَرِهَ الْمُشْرِكُونَ Allah said, never mind, how the mushrik might not like it. This is the destiny of his deen. Then he repeats the same verse, again, another place in the Quran. He said, هُوَ الَّذِي أَرْسَلَ رَسُولَهُ بِالْهُدَىٰ وَدِينِ الْحَقِّ لِيُزَهِرَهُ عَلَى الدِّينِ كُلِّ وَكَفَى بِاللَّهِ شَهِدًا And enough is Allah is a witness to this fact that he's going to make his deen to prevail with you or without you. But in 1400 years, I'm asking my Egyptian, when I was there in Egypt, I said, I want to know, why is it that you are not able to reduce the Christian population by 1%? Why? It's either Allah's promise is not true, or you didn't do the job. You either didn't do the job. So they says, no, you see, this Mubarak fellow is no good. He doesn't allow us to do dawah to the Christian. He said, don't talk. Don't preach to the Christians.
The problem is political, you see.
He said that Sadat fellow was no good. That Nasser fellow was no good. You know, they are the guys who stopped us from doing dawah. I said, okay, maybe I accept your explanation. But I said, look, Mubarak yesterday, Sadat was yesterday, and Nasser was day before yesterday. Mm-hmm. But for 1,400 years, there was no Mubarak, no Sadat, no Nasser. Except for a few years, the British came, a few years the French came, but overall for 1,400 years, the Muslim has been the master of Egypt. Who stopped you? I want to know who stopped you from doing dawah.
Mm-hmm.
Either Islam is a spent force, Allah's promise is not true, he said, wa'adallahu haq, Allah's promise is true.
Yeah.
But I can't see it.
Surely, yeah.
What is the reason why the Muslim has not been able to talk to the Christian for 1400 years? Forget now. Forget Mubarak and Sadat and Nasser. I want to know for 1400 years, no. Why didn't you do the job?
Well, the worse in the past, it was worse. I have, please study the history, I mean modern history in Egypt, of Egypt. Imperialism, British imperialism had done a lot against Islam. He tried to ruin everything. and it was easy to go against imperialists. But it was not easy to go against each other. This is one problem. Again, the foreign fingers are playing behind every curtain. They are paying too much money. They are doing a lot of work day and night in Egypt. And I could say that our Christian community in Egypt, they are very clever. They are well off. They are deployed in the whole world, especially the new world, say America, Canada, and Australia. And the money is coming from all these sources to their families in Egypt. Not only money, but arms. Killings were taking place. You know, they were doing many provocations against Muslims, against the huge communities around them in the beginning, and then again coming accusing that they are
Muslims,
terrorists, extremists, fundamentalists, and so on. And regimes, ruling regimes, different ruling, Nasser, Sadat, and before, even during King Farouk. King Farouk was suspicious of Muslim elements. They killed Hassan al-Banna. You know Hassan al-Banna, of course. They killed him. The state killed him, not the people in the street. And they have done a lot also for Islam Dawah. And there are many young people who are doing very well, but unfortunately, they are doing also killings and robberies. And this is distorting the image of Islam inside and outside. Especially the huge propaganda machine in the world, Zionism, who controls the media in the world.
True.
If I am not mistaken.
No, that is true.
So day and night they are trying to distort completely the image of Muslims and Islam. And they are concentrating, maybe not in South Africa, but in Egypt. They are concentrating on Egypt, not Saudi Arabia, but Egypt.
Because Egypt is more open.
Yeah, and we have done, you have ulamas there. You could have met some of them in Al-Azhar, but ulamas are not Al-Azhar only. I consider you, brother, to me and to Da'wah, is something more than those ulama, official ulama of Al-Azhar. And they are told in open, you are an official mufti, he was told, in the newspapers. You are the mufti of the ruling system, he was said. Although the man is a very nice man, and he is a very good alim, but he's trying to compromise something. And then he said, this is my ijtihad. Up to him. It is between him and Allah. But Egypt and the Muslims there, the da'is there, to me, I am between them. I saw them. They did a lot. We are not very well accepted even in the foreign service to be praying. Sometimes they are mocking at us even here. I was praying somewhere, it was almost, you know, between Maghrib, Salat was about to be lost. So I did it in the open. Al-Ardu kulluha masjid. So I did it, they were laughing. My colleagues, ambassadors, what are you doing? I said, nothing. It happened one day in London, and it was Regent Park. It was the time of Salat, and the young kids were playing around. So I did my Salat. Nothing, no problem. Grass was here, and Allahu Akbar. It was called Zuzur, was Regent of the mosque,
right.
The good mosque,
right.
There.
It was nearby.
But we were far away,
right.
2 kilometers,
right.
Or something.
Right.
So I did it.
Right.
And the young kids, I have to take them and bring them back. So a lady came, an English lady, and said, are you doing yoga?
Right.
I said, it is a kind of yoga, but it is Islam prayers. She was asking more and more questions, and I told her, if you want more, there are sheikhs there in the center. You may go to them, you can get books there, and you can have more, or tapes, or whatever. You can have more idea about. And she was telling about wives. Have you got four wives? I said, why four? I need only one. As for me, right. It's only one.
Right.
Because I don't need any more.
Right.
She said, all of you have harem and something. I said, okay, it is not for all of us.
Right.
So the lady started, and after that, I remember Sheikh, there were two Egyptian sheikhs there doing dawah. They contacted me, and the lady came to my office after that, asking, I want to be a Muslim. I said, okay, go to Sheikh, and he will give you books and receive you after 1 week or 15 days, and then another time after 15 days to see if you are keen to be, and now that you can understand and compare both religions, Christianity and Islam, and you are willing, it's your own will, to be a Muslim. She said yes. And she brought the husband.
MashaAllah, MashaAllah.
So dawah is everywhere. I saw many, the butcher.
Right.
He was Pakistani.
Right.
And he was telling me in the evening, I was sick.
In London.
I was seeking for halal meat.
Right.
So I knew that
he is a Muslim.
And I was, you know, asking again and again, is it halal? He said, Wallahi, billahi, tallahi, is halal.
Right.
And he told me, I am doing dawah for 2 months a year, going to different places in the United Kingdom doing dawah. So alhamdulillah, الخير في وفي أمتي, the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام said, الخير في وفي أمتي إلى يوم القيامة. So you are a part of this khair,
like
and so. Others are there, and Egypt is بخير إن شاء الله. You know, and the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم praised Egypt as for good soldiers. Yeah. إذا فتحت مصر فاستوت بجندها خيرا فإنهم من خير أجناد الأرض. And it is true. Religion in Egypt is a very deeply rooted something for all.
Right.
But Copts or Christians of Egypt, they are very clever. If they are just small community, so they can, you know, say, we are yours, we are your brothers,
uh-huh.
We are Muslims in culture, uh-huh. So on. Okay.
Right.
But if you are one or two between 10, you will be tortured. Sitting with them or living with them, it is a real torture if they are the majority.
Right.
But you have to give the good example of tolerance to them. And I remember the elderly generations, in a way, they were more tolerant than nowadays. Why? Because nowadays they feel their strength, financially speaking, and in terms of arms, they have violated and hidden in Egypt. And this is a real problem for the government. If you say take the Ahmed Deedat's videotape about Christianity or Jesus is a God or not or something,
they ban it.
This will cause a very bad something or dispute between Muslims and Christians. That is why you may hear that Deedat videotapes about Christ, about Jesus. It is everywhere.
I know. And they
put it into Arabic.
Right.
And it is distorted. You hardly can hear it. But it is there, distributed secretly. It is in Egypt. I listened to one of these, yes. Arabic translated,
right.
tapes. done in Lebanon.
Right.
And I go and tell the kids, they are grown up, they are 32, 31, and 27. Alhamdulillah.
Yes, yes.
They are Wa'il, Tariq, and Muhammad.
MashaAllah.
They admire you too much. And I told them, as far as I get off those election observing, we are here as observers.
Right, right.
I'll go and see Mr. Deedat, salute him. And carry your greetings to him. So it is not only mine, but mine, my wife, and my three children. Barakallahu fiik wa shakarallahu lak.
Before you go, I'd like to present this book to you.
Thank you. I have carried 2 weeks ago.
Right.
A copy of Al-Mushaf al-Sharif printed in Egypt.
Right.
And there is a praying mat. This I'll bring it before I leave, 2-3 days later, inshallah. I brought it here,
right.
And there was another ambassador called Shilbaya.
Right.
He was with me, and we went around and around after Salah, and we didn't find you. And today again, I went to the mosque, and I was sent to different places,
right.
And then at last,
Allah.
I did it, alhamdulillah.
Let me, oh yes, the card.
This is office, telephone, and fax. I write my home number in the back of the card.
Right. The card.
Oh, thank you.
For my pen, I believe.
Thank you very much. Shukran.
And have you got a translation of the Qur'an? Translation into English?
I have many. In Egypt, one of the big one, this one, the other one is Muhammad Yusuf.
Yusuf Ali.
Yusuf Ali, yes.
This,
yes. This one I have got.
Arabic, English?
Arabic, English,
and
yes.
The commentary.
Yes, I have got it. Is in my library at home.
Right, in Cairo.
In Egypt.
And I hope your children... You see, this book, the size of it is formidable. 2,000 pages. And in this day and age, it's very difficult for a person to sit with a book, 2,000 pages, to go through it. So...
But for scholars, it is very useful.
Yes. Yeah. So now I'm suggesting that, you know, we draw the attention of our children, because they opened the book, and it is a formidable book. See, the Qur'an is a very concentrated book. It's unlike the other religious scriptures. I have read the Hindu books, the Ramayana, the Bhagavad Gita. I have read them. I have read the Holy Bible. They are like stories, once upon a time. The fox and the grape, the wolf and the lamb. It makes easy reading. The Qur'an is not like that. So, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ. Say, He is Allah, the one and only, Allahu Samad, God the Eternal, Absolute, لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُولَدْ. He does not beget and is not begotten, وَلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٍ. There's nothing like unto Him. I said, what did I say? So, well, you said there's only one God. I say, what else? So, well, it's got no father, no son. I say, what else? Finish. Because it's very concentrated. It's not like a story. I read you the Bible. You'll never forget in 100 years. While He, Judah, the father of the Jewish race, was going to Timnath to share his sheep. You won't remember the name Timnath, but he was going to share his sheep. And he sees a woman sitting by the roadside. He thinks she's a harlot, a whore. So he comes up to her and he says, allow me to come in unto thee. Means, let me have sex with you.
Mm.
So she says, what will you give me? Teaching prostitution in the book of God. What will you give me? So they didn't have cash or credit card those days. So he said, I'll send you a goat kid. So what guarantee that I will give it? You know, I'd have sex, enjoy me, and you go away and you don't send it then? So what guarantee do you want? So your signet, your ring, and your bracelet, you still wear bangles those days. And your staff, Asai Musa. So the old man gave it to her and cohabited with his daughter-in-law and made her pregnant. Twins! One hit! The old man. The father-in-law, he commits incest with his daughter-in-law and makes her pregnant. Now, that story you can never forget. Because while I was telling you, you could visualize the scene. But when I say, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ اللَّهُ السَّمَدْ لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُولَدْ وَلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ, you can't visualize. You can't visualize the meaning. So now, you have to grapple with it. So you need a translation with a commentary for us. Without a commentary, again, it's too difficult, too much. It's too heavy.
Mm.
So now, this book here, at the back of it is an index, a very comprehensive index.
Yes.
Once you introduce the young man to the index, he says, man, what are you looking for? You don't know the position of woman in Islam. Women! Chapter 2, to be referenced. Chapter 4, verse 1, false charges against women, how to be treated, modesty. What do you want to know? You want to know about unbelievers. Everything about unbelievers. What you want to know? You want to know about signs of Allah, his miracles. You want to know about reward and punishment. You want to know about the Qur'an, what the Qur'an says about the Qur'an. You want to know about Jesus, open J. You know about Moses, open M. Everything. Everything on your fingers.
Exactly.
You know about man, the nature of man. Why is gerent on earth? He's tested by God. Things men covet, the psychology of man. Things that men love most. He's created from clay for a term. He's called to account. We will return to Allah. Confusion of the wicked. Everything about man. You know about marriage and the M. You want to know about Jesus and the J. Everything about Jesus on your fingertips.
Yeah. Yeah.
So what it does is that it makes interesting reading. Now, the topic that interests you, look up those topics. You are reading about Ad and Thamud and Mawlud and I'm not interested. Maybe you're not interested. So what do you want to know about Ad and Thamud and Nabi Hud and all that? Doesn't seem to click.
Mm.
So you put it away. Then you're not likely to take it down again. Because now what you were looking for, you know, so all about Ad and Thamud, and I don't know about Ad and Thamud and Qawmi Tubba and I don't know all that. So once you put it away, you're not likely to take it down because it was too heavy. Too heavy. But now once you go through the index, say many things makes interesting reading. What does Allah say about this? What does Allah say about that? The Christians. To me, the easiest way to talk to the Christian is the Quran. Is the Quran. When I meet the Christian, I accept that they are all good people. I treat them as good. Because Allah tells minhumul mu'minuna wa aktharuhumul fasiqun. Among them there are good people. وَلَوْ آمَنَ أَحْلُ الْكِتَابِ لَكَانَ خَيْرٌ لَهُمْ مِنْهُمُ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ وَأَكْثَرُهُمُ الْفَاسِقُونَ. So I treat them all as mu'min, good people. The good people, I says, you know, we believe in Jesus. I said, yes. You know, we believe that he was one of the mightiest messengers of God. I said, really? Maybe he's thinking that you want a cigarette from him, you want some chocolate from him. What does the guy want? He says, you know what my Quran says? He says, no. I said, you know the Quran says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. وَإِذْ قَالَتِ الْمَلَائِكَةُ يَا مَرْيَمُ. So behold, the angel said, O Mary, إِنَّ اللَّهَ اصْطَفَاكِ. Allah has chosen thee, وَتَحَرَكِ, purified thee, وَاصْطَفَاكِ عَلَى نِسَاءِ الْعَالَمِينَ, chosen thee above the women of all nations. يَا مَرْيَمُ اقْنُتِي لِرَبِّكِ وَاسْجُدِي وَارْكَعِي مَعَ الرَّاقِعِينَ. So, O Mary, worship thy Lord devoutly, prostrate thyself and bow down and pray with those who bow down. ذَلِكَ مِنْ أَنْبَاءِ الْغَيْبِ نُوحِيهِ إِلَيْكَ. This is part of the tidings of the things unseen which you reveal unto thee, O Messenger, by inspiration. وَمَا كُنْتَ لَدَيْهِمْ إِذْ يُلْقُونَ أَقْلَامَهُمْ أَيُّهُمْ يَكْفُلُ مَرْيَمَ وَمَا كُنْتَ لَدَيْهِمْ إِذْ يَخْتَصِمُونَ. This is what the Quran says. Have you seen the Quran? No, you haven't read it? No. So have a look. And when the guy sees this, wallah, I have seen again and again, tears well up in their eyes. When you read it to them, the Quranic words of the Quran, Allah's kalam, and the meaning, tears start rolling down their cheeks.
Yeah. Mm.
But now, nobody is doing it. You see, the Egyptian Christian, he knows all this. But you have to draw his attention. You have to draw his attention. And what better? You're schooling together. And there's no separate school for the Christians and the Muslims, is there?
Except for religion lessons.
No, right.
No, but they are taking their
own. But you are eating together, having lunchtime together, playing together.
They are attending Islamic lecture.
Right, right. Mm. But now you are not talking.
We are.
Really speaking.
We are.
Because I'm asking the Sheikhs of Al-Azhar. I asked them. I said, you read the Quran? I said, yes. I said, you understand what you read? I said, oh, not like you Hindis. You people read like a parrot. You don't know what you're reading. I said, no, that is true. We Hindis. There's a system. Your forefathers gave it to us. All the non-Arabs. They gave us a system of reciting like a parrot. And we're carrying it on. Allah will reward us, inshallah.
It was not their mistake anyhow. Also, it is their language, their religion's language, but it is different from their mother tongue.
No, besides that, even if it's a mother tongue. You see, what happened is this, that you came there as a trader to do business. You didn't come to do missionary work. See, when your forefathers came to barter the dates, they didn't come as missionaries.
No.
They came to do business. Mm. So in the process, my people say, these people are good people. You also like to be one of you. I said, very easy. Come, give me your hand. So we give the hand. Say, La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, say, you're a Muslim. Now you mustn't eat the pigs, right? You mustn't eat dead animals, right? You mustn't eat blood, right? You mustn't drink alcohol, right? Whatever you said, right. Now he said, you must pray five times a day, come, I'll show you. Make wudu like this, make salat like that. So they taught the people. But I said, what about the children? I said, no, we leave this young fellow, the 16-year-old, on your boat. You might have had some young guys. I said, look, we leave this fellow here, and he'll teach the children until we come next time. We'll pick him up. That's right. So left the young fellow behind. That guy is not a teacher. He knows alif bata. He knows how to join the words to produce the sound. So that's what he taught. What he knew. He is not a linguist. He is not a teacher.
But he was an example in himself.
Not to him, what he knew. He gave.
Uh-huh.
See, he's not teaching as a language.
No.
Okay, this is Alhamdu. What is Alhamdu? This is Allah, Balla, Talla, Salla. Made us to produce a sound. But what was Allah, Balla, Talla, Salla? We didn't know. He couldn't teach us. He couldn't communicate. So that's a system he gave us, your forefathers. And we carried on that system. The unfortunate part is today, we are all grown up now. We are not new converts anymore. This is a beautiful system for a new convert. But we are not new converts.
Hmm.
Some 400 years my people have become accepted Islam.
Yeah.
And still I am treated as a new convert by my alims. My child is still a new convert. My grandson is still a new convert. The teaching, this is a system for a new convert. Produce the sound, fit as in salat. How to quickly fit you in the salat so we can pray together. That was the aim, to pray together. So we started doing that, we pray together, but we don't understand one word. But now, he said, not like you Hindis. You Hindis, you read like a parrot. That means all non-Arabs. We all read like parrots. And we don't know what we are reading. Hop. That's hop. But I said, you understand what you read? I said, yes. That's your language. That's your language now. And even after 1400 years, that Arabic of the Quran is still understood by the Arab when he reads it. It's understood.
Yeah.
وَلَا تَقْرِبُوا الزِّنَا. You know, man, what it means. يَا أَهْلَ الْكِتَابِ تَعَالَوْ. You know what it means. This is 1400 year old. 1400 year old English, you will never be able to understand if somebody is talking. Shakespeare in English, you can't follow. You don't know what the hell he's talking about. But the Arabic of the Quran, still after 1400 years, you can understand. The Arab, you can understand. So I said, Allah is telling you. He's telling everybody. But since you understand, it's more directly addressed to you, the Arabs. Allah is telling you. قُلْ يَا أَهْلَ الْكِتَابِ. Say, O people of the book, لَا تَغْلُوا فِي دِينِكُمْ. Do not go to extremes in your religion.
Mm-hmm.
You understand that? You understand that? Don't go to extremes in your religion. You understand that? لا تغلو في دينكم. You understand that? I said, yes. I said, are you telling them that? He says, no. Are you telling that to the Christians? لا تغلو في دينكم ولا تقولوا على الله إلا الحق. Are you telling them that? He says, no. So Allah is telling you, ولا تقولوا ثلاثة. Don't say Trinity. You say Trinity? You believe in Trinity? In your masjids, you're Muslims in Egypt, do they believe in the Holy Trinity? Father, Son and Holy Ghost? No. Then who is Allah talking to? He is talking to the Christians. It is for you to go and find them who say that God is a three in one. Go and tell them, وَلَا تَقُولُوا ثَلَاثَ إِنَّهُ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ. Just stop it, it will be better for you. إِنَّمَ اللَّهُ إِلَهُ وَاحِدٌ. For your Allah is one, Allah is not three in one. Are you telling them that? The Sheikh says, no. So Allah is telling you, لَكَدْ كَفَرَ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا إِنَّ اللَّهُ الْمَسِيُّ بْنُ مَرْيَمُ. Anyone who says that Jesus Christ, the Son of Mary, is God, is making kufr, is an act of blasphemy, treason against Allah. وَقَالَ الْمَسِيُّ. But Christ said, يَا بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلُ أُوْتُوا فِي إِسْرَائِيلَ لَعْبُدُ اللَّهُ وَشِبَ اللَّهُ رَبِّي وَرَبُّكُمْ, who is my Lord and your Lord. إِنَّهُ مَنْ يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ, whoever will associate anyone with Allah, فَقَدْ حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ الْجَنَّةَ, Allah will make jannat haram for them. وَمَأْوَاهُ النَّارُ, and the fire of hell will be their dwelling place. وَمَا لِلظَّالِمِينَ مِنْ أَنصَارٍ, and for the wrongdoers there will be no one to help. Are you telling them that? He says, no. So Allah is telling you, قُلْ, say, يَا أَحْلَ الْكِتَابِ تَعَالَوْ. You understand? Ta'ala?
Yeah.
He said, yes. So what is Ta'ala? He says, come.
Mm.
Are you calling them? Who's Ahlul Kitab? You? Your father? Who's Ahlul Kitab? He says, the Jews and the Christians. So Allah is telling you, call them. Are you calling them? He says, no. I said, I don't know why.
He is not.
He says,
but it is done day and night by us, by others, normal people.
No,
the sheikhs.
No, the alims are not doing their job.
The alims are reluctant nowadays and for 40 years to do it.
But now this Allah is telling them, say, Al-Kitab, ta'alo, call them. If you are working for me, you working for me, and I see the Sheikh bin Baz going down the road, you know, of Saudi Arabia, Mabita, Al-Alam al-Islami.
You had been to Saudi Arabia for 3 years.
MashaAllah. I said, Afi, see that old man there? Go, call him. Go, call him. So you tell me, Mr. Deedat, there is nur on your face. Your beard is like silk. I said, Khabis, call that man. He said, Mr. Deedat, I'm prepared to wash your feet. And I'm prepared to drink the water. If I was the old-fashioned king, I'll chop off your head. You blame me for that? I'll chop off your head, cut your head off. I'm telling you, call that man.
Do your job.
That's all. He said, call him.
Yes, yes.
I want to know, you understand Arabic? He said, yes. So Allah is telling him, call him. Are you calling him? He said, no, I want to know why. I want to know why. So you blame Sadat and Nasser and Mubarak?
No, you can't go blaming anybody. You have
because
to do
now,
it.
For 1400 years there was no Nasser and no Sadat.
But it was done all the time.
But how is
you
it?
You know we are together.
One second. If the job was being done, you would be able to reduce the Christian population by 1%.
Yeah.
But from what I that what naturally you multiplied, they might not be multiplying at the same rate as you, because the better living condition.
They are multiplying more than us because they are instructed by church.
Right, okay.
To go
but
ahead,
normally
get more sons.
Right. Normally, the man who's affluent, his birth rate is lower because he's got too many other distractions. The guy who's got nothing else to do is planting the seed. You know, that's his only pastime. You see? So I was thinking that maybe the Muslim was multiplying faster.
I am not defending anything. I am not defending even myself. But I think you haven't enough time to see the real thing in Egypt if you just go through the villages to the ordinary man, to the very poor and the very simple man in the village. They are doing the job. we as students, pupils, students and everything, we are doing the job, we are trying, but in a special way not to hurt the whole social and political something. Because there were, you know, the disputes and the killings. They are killing, they are destroying houses and shops and so on. And they were even trying to have a Vatican in Egypt, in Asyut. They tried during Nazis. They said, okay, let us have a little big city such as Asyut for Christians. And he dealt very well with them.
Nasser.
So, it is done day and night, but they are provided all these years by foreigners, by their sons abroad. Millions of them are abroad now. In Australia, they are creating disputes and many things against the regime. They say, they are saying, we are discriminated against. We are prevented to, in Egypt, our relatives there. They are unable to do their prayers and to build their churches. This isn't true, of course.
No, I see in Cairo new churches going up.
Yeah.
And multi-million dollar churches.
Sure. So,
to me, actually, I think the Christian is ruling Egypt. Look, because I was asking an ambassador.
Do you remember the speech of the Sadat? Sadat was trying to get closer to them and using them even against the majority of the Muslims, the majority of the people. At last he discovered when he went to America, when he went to the United Kingdom, they were throwing him with something, you know, saying that their relatives are discriminated against. Then he came back, he found the bow, what we call the bow, the Egyptian Coptic bow, Shunuda III, second Shunuda. Second Shunuda the second.
Right.
And then he said, Sadat that time, I am a Muslim ruler of a Muslim country. As if he discovered for himself this reality. And Shunuda was about to be, he went to an exile of himself to a church in the very deep desert and stayed there. But the ruler, the regime, all of a sudden discovered that they were not loyal, that loyal to him. Although they were the minority, they were taking many chances over Muslims. But to say that we are ruled of no way at all. And at all times, even during imperialist time, the British, they tried hard. They tried even to give foreign nationalities to them. Mm-hmm. They tried to have a prime minister, you know, Butros Ghali, mm-hmm. Not this one,
right.
But his grandfather.
Yeah.
They tried to, and he was a prime minister of Egypt for some time.
Yes?
Yes. And there was a Jewish minister of finance,
uh-huh.
That time.
Yes.
But, alhamdulillah, al-Islam in Egypt is completely behind. And you see those people trying to imitate the ugly picture of the West.
Right.
Now, what you see in the universities, all young ladies or girls covering all of them, and the regime itself was agitated by this thing, yeah. And even the boys, they were trying to put galabiya or thawb only,
right.
And they were even prevented from entering the university and the classrooms, but they insisted, and they were a little bit hot-headed young people.
Yeah,
I didn't like it.
Right.
Especially quarreling, beating, killing, I don't like it at all. This is not Islam by all means.
Right.
So what you can see in television, through CNN or whatever, or the British channels and so on, is not the real image of Islam in Egypt. Go to the simple man and woman in the village and see how Islam is prevailing. Alhamdulillah. It is there. In Egypt, especially in Egypt, see Ramadan in Egypt. Everybody is fasting.
I'm sure.
See prayers. They are there. And young people, young girls, they are still arrested sometimes.
Right.
In my area, we have a mosque very close, 200 meters.
Right.
In Ramadan, they were coming, police cars, collecting those young people and women, taking them, arresting them.
For what?
They were gathering, they were, you know, shouting slogans, Islamic slogans and so on. They said, okay, you can pray, but you can't shout at night and have those microphones and so on. So they were arrested, hundreds of them. I saw them.
Yes, yes.
From my balcony, I was
watching.
And my son was about to go to pray there.
Right.
Discriminately, they were just collecting, arresting them and taking them. And they were let. They released him later on. So it is there. And it is dangerous for Egypt to get the whole nation divided that way. And again, the foreign fingers, the evil foreign fingers, again they are playing behind the curtains, giving money, giving arms, you know, and trying to divide. Although it is, you can see a kind of tolerance in the villages. Myself, a Muslim, my neighbor, a Christian, or my colleague, or whatever, we were going smoothly. We were both tolerant. But nowadays, it is almost 10, 20 years. Killings were going around in Upper Egypt, in Cairo, Alexandria, ruining churches and mosques, killing families, whole families, simple families, weak families, poor families. What for?
Just because.
And they just wanted to have another Lebanon in Egypt. This couldn't happen, and I say it. No way to have this second Lebanon, Egypt, by all means. They are a little bit richer. They are more rich than Muslim.
Average Christian will be more educated.
More educated, is more rich.
Right.
They are a very cooperative minority.
United.
United, very united.
More united.
Inside the church.
Right.
If there is a poor man, they will go and help him to have a shop or to have something to do and earn his living. This is sometimes is lost between Muslims. Although 30, 40 years ago, I can tell you, we had very close community, even in big cities like Cairo. Now, you don't ask about your direct neighbor. Not Sabia, not the seventh neighbor, but direct neighbor. You don't say Eid Mubarak or something. You are closing your door and he's closing his door. This is happening now in Egypt. We dislike it. We don't like it. We are searching for the real Egypt now. What has happened? We are asking all the time when we come back. People have more money, but what is happening now? We are not cooperating anymore as we were in the past, 30, 40 years ago. But we are coming back, alhamdulillah.
And when I said that, you see, the Christians seem to be controlling Egypt, I said this in Bombay. I met the ambassador, the Egyptian ambassador in Bombay, and I met...
When was that? Because he was a Christian one.
No, this is about four or five years ago.
If it was Hilal Nasheed, he is a Christian. And he is here in South Africa, by the way.
I can't remember the name. But now, the ambassador, at some function, I was invited for dinner, and they were also there. The Egyptian ambassador and the manager of Saudi Airlines. They were both there in that function. So I'm asking these two, I said, you know, every airway has got an in-flight magazine.
Hmm.
Saudi Arabia has got, they call Ahlan wa Sahlan. Pakistan has got something in Urdu to say, Mubarak. You know. Kenya has got Msafiri. South Africa has got Springbok. Britain, UK has got Nightlife. So everyone has got their own in-flight magazine, which you expect your customer to take it away and read something about you, your airways, your country and all that. I'm asking, what is the name of your in-flight magazine?
Mm.
Simple question.
Mm.
And the Egyptian ambassador couldn't tell me. And the manager of the airline, maybe he was trying to be too clever. He says, so what? No, I said, I want to know what is the name of your in-flight magazine. Surely you have a name.
There is a magazine, there is two of them. Mm.
No, what I say, I ask, there is, so what is the name?
Mm.
He said, well, the ambassador or the fellow. He said, well, look, somebody asked you, what is the color of your curtain in your house? You might not be able to say, and that's a fact.
Yeah.
You know, I'm living there. Mm. Now you ask, what is the color of your curtain? So I had to think very hard. What is the color? You know? If it's some pale shade.
Oh, yes.
So, I said, no, man, this is simpler than that. You know, do you travel by Egypt Air?
Yes, sure.
No, I'm asking there.
Yeah.
You said, yes. So, surely you must have seen the magazine. What is the name?
I have seen the magazine several times, but right. I can't tell you with the name now.
Right. I can excuse you, you see. But now, you Saudi airline. You must tell me. Why? Cooperate, man. You know, the Saudi, the Egyptian ambassador. Cooperate, man. Tell me. He said, look, I can't, like you tell me, honestly. He said, look, I've traveled, but I've seen it. But I can't seem to recollect the name. I can excuse you for that. But you're trying to now hide your ignorance to say, so what? What? You're not supposed to know all that. I said, look, wait a minute, man. I'm asking a simple question, whether you know. I said, now I tell you what the name is.
He was taken by the surprise and yes. He was unable to know.
So, I'm telling him, the name is Horace.
Horace, yes, exactly.
So I'm asking, who is Horace? Your grandfather. Who is Horace? Come, tell me now. Horace is the god of your Mushrik ancestors.
Yeah.
I said, who gave you that name to put on your on your magazine? Who gave you that name? In the Arabic language, damn it all, you couldn't find another Arabic word. It's so rich. Arabic is so rich.
Yeah, for sure.
And you can't find an Arabic word like
but
this
Horace.
Guy. But Horace, you tell me now. I said, you see, the Christian is stealing your brains. He stole your brains.
It could happen.
You see, that means it's the Christian's job, not yours. I'm sure it didn't occur to you.
It could happen. I tell you something. In London, we have a tourist bureau,
right.
And they have arranged for a very nice touristic book about Egypt.
Right.
Do you know what is the first sentence in that touristic book? It says, the first sentence, Egypt is the land of Copts. It is right. What are Copts?
They're the original people.
They are not the the Christians, but the Egyptians.
Right. They're the original people of Egypt.
And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was putting a Coptia,
right.
That is, you know, some abaya,
right.
And from Egypt, it
right.
Was called the Coptia.
Right.
Made in Egypt.
And Mary the Copt.
Egyptian.
And Mary the Copt.
And
was one of his wives.
Yes.
She is Coptia. So, Maria Coptia.
If you take it in the easy way, so it is the land of Copts, ancient
right.
Egyptians.
Right.
But he put it
right.
Intentionally to introduce
right.
Egypt.
The Coptic Christians.
Yes. He meant that it is the land of Christians.
Right.
And they are carrying this meaning in their minds.
Right.
If you discuss it with them,
right.
They are telling us, especially in London and abroad.
Right.
I was the consul, the first consul there in 75 up to 79.
Right.
And one of these people, who were friends, anyhow, was telling me that you are foreigners, you are Bedouins coming from Arabia, conquered our land, but we are the owners, the real owners of the land. I said, take it easy, come on, my dear brother and friend, let us discuss it. If you are Egyptian and I am not, how come? How?
It's very interesting.
So it is there in their mind. If you are praying here, I will pray Zohar. I am not going to take, I am very happy to meet you today. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. And if you let me, I'll bring the printed Quran in Egypt to you. I am leaving by, inshallah, by Friday or before.
This is for my son. But use the index.
I have it. This I was distributing in London.
Right.
I have taken it from Mr. Salim Azam in London,
right,
and distributing it to several Muslims and Christians,
mashallah,
in London.
Mashallah.
I have many tens of it. So I have one in my library in Egypt.
Inshallah.
Thank you very much. And you will allow me to bring the praying
in. Most welcome.
Yeah. But tell me where I find you. Where I can find you.
Yeah.
This place. On Friday, because I will be rushing to the airport. My plane will be at 2 o'clock, inshallah. If I can catch the prayer and go immediately to the
airport. If not, it's accepted in the sight of Allah.
I leave it.
No, I leave it. The sight of Allah is accepted.
Alhamdulillah.